Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm doing about MLflow. We will do a fine-tuning of a flantified model, a base size, and we will use an approach of sequence to sequence to do a document classification model. Okay, let's go quickly. Okay. So I had prepared an output as usual. Previously I had done exactly the same exercise. I'm creating a custom classifier for an arbitrary number of classes. The idea is to create a tool, something that you provide the user an interface. The user can prepare a number of documents, label them, and use these documents to create a custom classifier based on these labels and train a model and build their own classifier to train the documents that they have on their data lake according to the classes that they already had specified. So I have I'm following two different approaches. I'm using moving phase models, public access, public models, and for this specific problem, I'm following two different approaches. Yesterday, I uploaded a video where I did exactly the same that you are gonna see here today in this tutorial, but I use instead to sequence to sequence classification, that is the one that we are gonna use today, we use sequence classifications, which essentially is something different. We use the same model, but the way that you use the architecture is slightly different. In sequence classification, you take the encoder and you put in top on the encoder a classifier, a conventional classifier, which create a probability per class you have in your labels, and you just later on choose the most likely class or the class which got the higher probability, and this is the class that you assign to that input. And in this case, in sequence to sequence, we use the transformer, which take to generate a label. We take the input, we tokenize the input. We do this as well. We tokenize the input as well in the sequence classification. But here, we tokenize the input and we generate text. And then on this text, is later evaluated versus the classes that you have in your dataset. But you are generating tokens, a number of tokens as output, and then you later have to evaluate if this generated text is equal, not equal to the label that has that input. And that's just how we train the model in this case. So we had two different ways, and the ways are how we prepare the logic to train the models, and the classes that we use are different. So, I upload yesterday some videos, a video explaining how to do it with sequence classification, and today we will do it with sequence to sequence. We are going to use MLflow, or all these videos are related to MLflow, how to use it to in combination with our LLMs, not only for fine-tuning. We will use it in other videos for prompting, for evaluating prompting as well, RAG, other functionalities that now are also integral part of MLflow. MLflow, as you probably know, is a tool that is a framework which allows you to work or leverage the whole machine learning lifecycle, and it's a well-known, very broadly used tool that are integrated with most of the ML platforms like Machine Learning Studio, Azure Machine Learning Studio, Vertex AI from Google, SageMaker, Databricks, and others. Also has a full integration with most of the, practically all, it's a no-brainer, all of the libraries, Scikit-learn, SGBooks, Spark, like GBN, Prophet, and if you go to deep learning, you had also TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras, everything that, well, if you know something that are outside here and is still in use because there is CAFE or others that probably today are not how to say very not very used, just let me know. But well, for what you see here, as you can see, is this when I say fully integrated, is that you will see, as you probably saw in the previous video, you are following the channel, that it's very easy to log all the activity that the model did during training, inference, whatever of the phases you are modeling, feature engineering, evaluation, monitoring. With if you have a full integration of your library with MLflow, you will see here how later this that is produced is just with two lines of code. And oops, sorry, this is true. We need to just start the process. Let's start because and also to expose the server, as we are working in a Colab Pro with an L4 GPU, a GPU with 24 gigabytes of memory, more than enough. To expose the MLflow server, we are using ngRok. I also talk about what is that. It's a tunneling tool which allow you to well, to tunnel the traffic of an application which is running behind a firewall or behind a proxy, expose it to a public IP address. It's free. There is also paid account, but I'm using free. And then on you had agents and SDKs for many technologies. And then once you create your account, you get an authentication token, and you can start to tunnel and expose whatever you are using. As you probably know, using Colab Pro, you cannot access to something is running in this container. Colab Pro at the end is a container running a improved Jupyter server, something like that, with some additional enhancements and with access to GPUs and some other stuff. But well, essentially that they only open 443 and 80. 443 is a no-grown only. To they expose only this port, but using the capabilities that probably had their application firewall or the reverse proxy that they are using, something like NGINX, you can use the connect method and tunnel traffic of an arbitrary TCP port through this through the reverse proxy or through the application firewall, just using the method connect that they had to have activated because of working with HTTPS. And you can create an stateless connection from this from the port that is using your application. In our case now, MLflow in the port 5000, you can establish an stateless connection to ngRok infrastructure, and they will expose the traffic into an public IP address in the port 443. I will show you now. Here we install the requirements, and with the interactive self, we just run the MLflow server in the port 5000. We had the MLflow server into the container where it's running Colab Pro, and we will have the client as well in the notebook itself. We instantiate the NGROK client, and here we create we set the authentication token, and now we are tunneling the traffic directed to the port 5000 to this public IP address. And then if you click on the public IP address, which is on the NGROK infrastructure, you will see now the MLflow server. Here we are. Okay, so we had I run it before a number of experiments. Now we are going to run again the notebook end to end. So we import the libraries. Today I will split correctly the train dataset. The train dataset that is split in two sizes. 20% for validation during training, and in the video I upload before where I did the DeFi, o sea, sequence classification using the model just with the other approach where you just use the encoder and put a classification head in top of the encoder. I didn't do this correctly, so I didn't ensure or I didn't enforce that I had the same balance of the same number of the samples in the train and validation dataset using during training, and today I did it correctly. So I had the two files where I had my training data and other dataset, other file where I had my hold out dataset, and then just I load it, and then here I split it using stratification. For stratification, I use the Y. This I will ensure that I had the same number, or sea, the same proportions in training and validation datasets. These two datasets will be used during training during training. Sorry. Here I create the datasets to be used, the object datasets from datasets library, Hugging Face dataset library. And you can take a look here at the content. I'm counting the values of the label of the labels. So you remember what's the CV, oh sorry, the video I uploaded yesterday with the using the other approach, sequence classification. In here, I'm using a dataset which contains 200 documents, 100 CVs to 100 non-CV. The non-CV are documents for other, let's say, departments, commercial, compliance, also human resources, but not CVs, can be a job description, for example, but it's not a CV. I did it on purpose, just to differentiate exactly what is a CV or not. I'm trying to find the minimum number of documents that I need to create a custom classifier. I'm starting with two classes, and then on the idea is extend it to an arbitrary number of classes. And then again, I'm using these two different approaches and trying to understand which is faster, need less resources, and give me the best performance. I import the libraries here, differently than the previous video, in the other approach, where you need sequence classification, this class from Transformer. You will need here all the series that on the area of sequence to sequence classification. This is here creating on top of the transformer a sequence to sequence head, and you can use it to many purposes. You to take a look to the to how the T5 that I'm gonna use, the front T5 base, was done. It was done with that purpose. You can use the sequence to sequence generation. Here we are generating tokens. You can use it for many purposes. You can use it for prompting. You can use it for to generate a label, to generate something. And then I think here even we had number of cases. Parameter impact, blah blah blah. No, well, it's not. You can take a look to the document where it's described how T5 was created. It's just an example how this sequence to sequence approach is also how to say you will be is able to do classification, but is working slightly different to the conventional classification that is used on sequence classification, where you have a conventional classifier which gives you the likelihood of the different classes that you have in your dataset, in your labels, and you choose basically the class with the higher likelihood. In this case, you don't get that. You generate tokens, and you later evaluate if these tokens that you generate match with the tokens of the labels of your classes or your dataset. So this is different. Again, in the first one is a conventional classifier that where you use a transformer models. Here you are generating tests. This is a generative model, that we can use as well as classifier. And then on to do that, you need to use the correct classes. You have here, you have the auto model for sequence to sequence, the data collator, the trainer, and the class to prepare the arguments. We create some placeholders. We just load the tokenizer. Now we are going to calculate the max source length, which is it's gonna be 512, which is the maximum context window of this model. If we use a bigger one, it will be increased, but in this case it's 512, round about 2500 characters of tokens, considering that a token could be an average 5 chars. Some cases less, some cases more. Well, here we just calculate the number of tokens that had out labels. In this case, maximum is 5. You see our labels are CV and non-CV. So here, the maximum length, the max length of our labels is 5. You will see now why. We just create here. We define some the sequence to sequence trainer arguments. Conventional stuff, batch height 8. Don't use floating point 16 because it's not working with the T5. For epochs, well, saving the best model at the end of the. No, not the best model at the end. We just simply create processes. This is to tokenize the dataset. We are just replacing the also the last token with the minus 100. Why? Because this is not the tokens labels, you will see now, They are only integers positives, and then we had to use something to later differentiate with the sequence of a text is not it doesn't have the maximum length and not use as well the padding token to be part of the calculations that we will do to calculate the loss. No? In this case, again, the loss is calculated not in the in a conventional classifier. Here we use the labels. The labels in this case are a vector of tokens, and then on we cannot use the pack token ID to do the loss calculations because this is actually wrong. I will show you this now when you visualize what is the how it looks like the vector that represent a label, and you will understand in that moment why we need to do this pre-processing and post-processing in order to remove the tokenizer path token ID, which is included when you tokenize the labels, no? What we are doing here, no? We are doing tokenization of the input and also the labels. And also we compute the metrics similar, exactly the same that we did on the previous video in the other approach, but here we had to do some other pre-processing in order to convert the string labels in, well, the tokens in the tokens that we are producing in our generative model. We need to convert it first of all to strings, and after convert it to strings, we need to convert it to numerical values. From we will get after the tokenization, the coding, the token, the label predicted. We need to convert it to we will get a non-CV or CV, and then we will have to convert these strings to labels. Sorry, to integers in order to do correctly the calculations, because as you for sure know, we cannot use a string to calculate recall precision or ROC AUC or F1. Let me check if I run this. No, I didn't. So the last one was that. Now we create a dataset using a dataset dictionary which contains our train and test dataset of both that they are balanced, and then we tokenize the full dataset. So we get our input IDs, attention max, and labels. And then if you take a look to the label of the example one, you had four tokens which represent this is the end path and sentence. So you have three tokens non-CV. This is probably a non-CV. And then here you have the padding token. And this is what we are going to use to what we are doing in these functions. We are removing this to calculate correctly the loss during training. You see here. So this is done because this sentence is less than the 512 tokens, and obviously to later differentiate all these sequences into the data collator, we are using a path token, which is had to be a negative number in order not to interfere into the numbers. Well, the tokens numbers are always positive from 1 to n, depending on the num n is the vocabulary size used on your model. and one is a special number that we use for identify when the sequence is finishing, and again this is for padding. And then here we will use this in the data collator later to mix multiple labels on a single sequence. And we index first of all the labels in a single vector, and after that we need to deindex the vectors into correct labels, the vector of tokens that represent labels. We use that character to do that, and also we need to have something that is below zero and be able to identify the that number. It can be whatever on negative value, it can be -9, for example, or -500. The only thing is that you will need to remove that token, as we are doing here, to do the calculations, the loss calculations. So you take a look today. Sorry. If you look at the input IDs, is the tokenizer, and then we are finishing in one as well. This is the sequence of tokens, all of them positives, and each of them represent a token in your vocabulary. And it's gonna be 512, and yeah. And this is the representation. Obviously, if the input has more than 512 tokens, it's truncated, and they only take the initial 512 tokens, which again is around about 2,500. Characters, more or less. We load the model with auto model for sequence to sequence LM. We create the data collator for sequence to sequence. This is not used, so we don't need to use it. This is coming from a previous notebook where I create the data frame. Here we create the trainer as well, had to be sequence to sequence trainer. We set the tracking URI to our MRflow server, which is running in local. That's why we are pointing to the local address in the port. If we use HTTP, this means that we are not using a database as backend, and everything is going to be safe on our on the local file system where the MRflow server is running. So in this container, in the Colab Pro container, and we set the experiment. It is not created, it will be created. We can set another one just to use it. Training, let's put version something like version 2, and then what's producing that, it's just creating. You see experiment now, doesn't see creating new experiment. Now you go here and you just refresh. Okay, but probably we need to refresh here. Yeah, exactly, version 2, and also it's empty here. There is three of the three previous ones I ran. We create a folder into the our data lake. Remember, T5 fine tune. Well, I don't know what is not working, but okay. Now, and now we start the training. To start the training, we just use MFlow start run, and we use this create this object to collect all the metadata of this experiment. And here we had just trainer train. We print the metrics at the end of the process. It will not enter in this line actually, the process is not finished. And then we will save the model to local, and we will save the model as well to the experiment that we are running right now. Okay, so it's gonna take 3-4 minutes. I will stop here in order not to make it very large, so the video very long, and later I will continue with the rest. Okay, it's finished. As you see, we had only 4 epochs, and we got one. Well, I didn't expect less during training. It's a very powerful model with very simple tasks. And again, well, it's what it was expected. And here, we are logging the model with the transformer flavor, and this the sequence to sequence transformer is not fully supported by MLflow, but we don't care. What we only care is that we need to log the model to MLflow in order to later on retrieve this model from any other environment. Now here we are logging the model to the experiment. We can log the model as well to the model repository, and what we are interested in, exactly what we are doing here. We are creating here a dictionary with the model, and with the data, with the tokenizer, we create a dictionary, and this is what we are going to log here. You see here that we receive a warning that T5 for conditional generation is not supported. Yeah, in this case we don't care, and I will explain you a little bit later why, because we are just interested in using the MLflow server as repository to keep the model and the tokenizer, and later on retrieve it with MLflow tools and the MLflow library, and be able to use it in another environment. Here we are going to do it in the same environment, but the idea is to be this later create an endpoint and be able to retrieve the model just using the library MLflow. And then similarly, we keep control of and track of everything that we have done. So just imagine with this couple of lines or with this few code that we did here, everything that the model, how you set up the model is already in MLflow. This is because what I explained you at the beginning, everything that is fully integrated, all these libraries in traditional ML or deep learning, had integrated to automatically MLrun, sorry, MLflow capture everything that is happening when you train the model, or you evaluate the model, or you do hyperparameter tuning. It's prepared. It has internally a function which is autolog, and all these libraries just doing this when you introduce it in a block under width and you start a run. MLflow will capture. We had some hooks inside the introduction hubs inside the trainer, and is able to capture everything that is producing during training. You can see here you had this is details metadata of the experiment itself. As you see here, parameters of your sequence to sequence trainer. the model use everything that yeah, is plenty of information. Also the metric that were generated during training is generating as well all these graphics that you can use as well to evaluate training, evaluation and everything. We are loss, etc. See here is practically no loss after 40 steps, which is telling us that very powerful model for such easy tasks, no? And also the artifacts that, again, here we had pushed the trained model to MLflow server, and we had here the tokenizer and the model itself. And we had the metadata of our model, and we had different files which will allow us to deploy the model into any environment. You can use Conda, you can use PIP, Python environment with the py function. And then the advantage to use it to do it that way is that MLflow offers a common interface to log models, save models, retrieve a model from the model registry. All these methods are common across all the technologies which integrate with MLflow, and where you just need to use the correct class. In this case, we use transformers, and this way you know that you had a method that is log model, you will have a method that is load model, you will have a method that is, I don't know, whatever, save model to model registry. Everything is standard and exactly the same across all the technologies that you use. You can use here XGBoost, for example, instead of transformer, and you will have 100% a method that is log model, and it will have an argument artifact path. There is two different classes of arguments. Common arguments, which like artifact underscore path, or particular or local parameters, which are depending on the class itself. In this case, transformers use a parameter tax, but this probably in TensorFlow is not used in scikit-learn. In scikit-learn we may use something different as well, but there is some common, and the name of the method is common for all of them. On the object run, we had all the metadata that produced this experiment. Something very important: where in your server is the artifacts. If you go to ML artifacts, this you go to the experiment name. No, sorry, experiment ID is the 61. You had the run ID, but for E2, blah blah blah, artifacts, and here you had the folder that you specify in your artifact path. Sorry. Text classifier, and inside text classifier you have everything that you see here in artifacts. See here text classifier and everything components metadata model. The rest, in this case that we are not using a database to keep the metadata, the rest is going to ML runs, and you have the same. You go to the experiment ID, the run ID, and in the run ID you have meta YAML. And it's giving you the metadata at the level of the experiment. You had the metadata of the experiment, you had the name, remember, training version 2. And if you click on the, you had another meta, which is the same information that you see here on the run. And you have here as well all the metadata that you need to produce the metrics, epochs. This is the information that later MLflow used to build all the graphs, plots, dictionaries, and everything that you see on the GUI. This again can be saved in a database. Usually it's in a database, in a corporate database, but here we are working in a Colab Pro where I move this to a production environment. I will for sure use a global location where I have the MLflow, and you just will need to change the tracking URI, which tell us in which MLflow server you will log the activity or your experiments, the activity and the artifacts. What more? Here we just print the data key. We are going now to use the model info URI. Here when we lock the model, we create this here we receive all the metadata after logging the model. It's an object as well from we can check what we have here. Model info is an object from MLflow. You had all this stat. Model URI, model UUID, run ID, signature, for example, this is another attribute of the class. I don't know exactly. So it's this is inferring. You can take a look in the documentation what exactly are this model, this class. And here we are going to load the model using the URI. And we want to return the components, so the components are the transformers, this dictionary we have here. Now we are, you see, we are taking this from MLflow server. And let me just show you something. Probably is this. One second. You can take a look to what we had here. This is the tokenizer. And what is here code? This is the model. Okay. And now we just create another function to create our data set for evaluation. This is the holdout. This data was not seen during training. So it's exactly the same. These are CVs and non-CVs. Also the half are CVs, half are not CVs. We imported here the classification report. We take the model, we just get from the dictionary the model, the tokenizer, and here we prepare a classification. We just take the text, we tokenize the text, we move the inputs to the tokenized input to the GPU, it is available, and we generate code, we generate tokens. With our model, we take the inputs, the attention max and max length equal 5. And after that, once we take the output, we decode the output using our tokenizer, and we return the prediction. So here we are going to get something CV not CV in terms of the an string basic, and here we prepare our evaluation model. It's very simple. Just we will print the classification report. We go one by one to all exactly. We run it, and we evaluate the model. And then we are going to produce a prediction for every single record on our holdout dataset. It's taking some seconds. And okay, here we are. Not bad. It's, I was expecting to have one as well. I will check. But in any case, it's working very, very decent. This similar output that we get yesterday with the other approach. Sorry. It's get that one. Yeah, exactly the same. I need to prepare as well this code just to transform the metrics, sorry, the labels and the predictions into numerical values to produce the confusion matrix. But well, I leave this to you. You can practice as well at home or in your local environment with that, with your own data. It will be very easy for you to use this code just to do your own experiments. I will post it later as usual to the repository. You can play with that at your comments. And well, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. If you like it, give me a like. Subscribe to the channel if you didn't before. And share with your friends or colleagues if you consider that is useful and interesting also for them. Okay, see you soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.